Our final guest today has been a minister at the center in the Manmohan Singh government. In 2014, he moved to his home state of Puducherry, and in 2016, became the chief minister of the state. Please put your hands together to welcome our last guest this evening, Mr. V. Narayan Swamy, the chief minister of Puducherry. Okay, Mr. Narayan Swamy, we have a surprise for you. Anyone wants to guess what is the surprise we have for Mr. Narayan Swamy? Mr. Narayan Swamy on Skype today, joining us as part of the debate, is the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, Kiran Bedi.
See, I don't see any surprise in everything.
She's not joining us.
When it comes to us, we have to cross the bridge. And we should be prepared for it. Therefore, I don't think that anybody is going to be a Skype or even anybody is going to be a bottleneck, anybody is going to be blocking everything. We should do our work and we should concentrate on our work. And then the ultimate goal for any political person, especially the chief minister, is the welfare of the people.
But tell me, if on this program today I had Dr. Kiran Bedi sitting next to you, would you be happy, unhappy, uncomfortable, very comfortable with the idea? I'm asking you, what is your relationship with Dr. Kiran Bedi?
Now, I'll be doubly happy. Because, as far as I'm concerned, I've seen turbulent time in Delhi as a minister in the Prime Minister's office. Therefore, any kind of situation, even as a Lieutenant Governor, when Madam Kiran Bedi is coming here, I will definitely face her.
But what is, I still want to know, who runs Puducherry? Does V. Narayan Swamy run Puducherry or does Kiran Bedi run Puducherry?
No, this question you have to ask Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi.
Why?
Because she was appointed by the President on the recommendation of the Council of Ministers, especially the Prime Minister, because the Prime Minister knows better than all of us.
No, your smile is saying it all. You're not happy.
No. I tell you one thing. In fact, even last time also in the India Today Conclave in Chennai, I told very clearly that if everybody confine themselves with the nature of work given to them, the powers given to them, there will be no clash. When somebody exceeds the limit, the power that has been vested in them, and if they think that they are the only people who can take all decisions in a democratic country like India, leaving alone the elected representatives, it is not acceptable to me. Therefore, I am running the administration according to the rules of business, the Union Territories Act, the Constitution of India. Therefore, I need not afraid of anybody. If I follow the rules and regulation, and if it is for the welfare of the people, I can bend the law for helping the people. For that, if anybody comes in the way, I will definitely oppose them.
So is Kiran Bedi exceeding her powers?
It is obvious last time when in the last year's conclave, I said we are trying to observe and also just to tell her that the powers of the administrator as far as Puducherry is concerned is not like Delhi. In fact, under Article 239A of the Constitution and Article 240, first proviso is very clear. That is only for Article 240, first proviso has been enacted only for our Union Territory of Puducherry. They said the President can bring regulation for peace, progress, and good government of Union Territory of Puducherry when there is no legislative assembly is functioning. When the assembly comes into being, the President shall cease to exercise his powers of peace, progress, and good government. What does it mean? Even the President has no power to interfere in the elected government when there is an elected representatives are in power.
Do you want the
One minute. Power is representative. The agent of the President cannot take the powers into herself.
Do you want Kiran Bedi to be recalled?
No, it is for the government of India to take a call and the president of India to take a call.
Would that be your preferred option?
No, as far as I am concerned, in whichever way you ask me the question, I will tell you. I am very clear in my mind. Whosoever is appointed as a lieutenant governor of my state, I know how to handle the state.
Do you believe, though, I will try one last time. Do you believe, though, that she is unfit to be the lieutenant governor of Puducherry?
That my people of the state. See, I tell you one small example. We have taken oath of secrecy. The governors and lieutenant governors also, they have taken oath of secrecy. Any official communication which is confidential should not be divulged to the public. Day in and day out, you find that Twitter, Facebook, and WhatsApp, every day all the official communication, which is confidential communication, is coming in the media. That is clear violation of the oath of office or the oath of secrecy that has been taken by the constitutional body. Therefore, the people will judge, our people of the state. In fact, earlier I was able to win over her. I used to tell her very clearly, this is the limit of your power. And now when she goes to the villages, in the name of inspection, the people started opposing. People started gathering here. From that she can understand. She should understand.
So you come, we won't talk about Kiran Bedi. We've talked enough. You have basically said she's acting in an unconstitutional manner. I've got my headline there. We'll... But more seriously.
After discussing for 10-15 minutes, you are able to understand only now.
You come from one of the smaller states, yeah, of the country. How difficult is it for you, in a sense, to be able to bridge the gap between you and Delhi? Because one of your complaints has been that Puducherry, your concerns are not heard by Delhi. Is it because you are a Congress chief minister and we have a BJP prime minister? Or is it simply the distance that exists between a small state like Puducherry and Delhi, that you claim that your complaints, your concerns, your grievances are not heard in Delhi?
No, in fact, it's a very important question. I will have to answer this. As far as our state is concerned, there are two states in the country, the union territories with the legislature. The state, full-fledged states are there and union territories are there. The Finance Commission, Central Finance Commission, has been constituted from time to time by the Government of India for devolution of funds for the states. For union territories, there is separate Finance Commission. As far as the union territories with the legislature is concerned, the Government of India kept it vacuum. When I said that we should devolution of funds for the state of Union Territory of Puducherry and also Delhi, it should be by constitutional means. Whether it was our earlier government, the present government, they have not taken a call on that. Neither they are treating me and Delhi as a man or woman. Because whenever we want funds from the Government of India, they say you are a state. Whenever we want concession like union territories, they say you are not entitled to the funds, because only union territories are entitled to. You have got a legislature of your own. In the GST Act, we are treated as a state. But in the Constitution, we have been made as a union territory. We are in a nebulous situation.
You are neither man or woman, as you put it, or you are na ghar ka na ghat ka, as they say in North India, right?
Therefore,
you are caught in the middle.
Today morning, I had a meeting of the finance ministers, meeting by the chaired by the our honorable finance minister, Arun Jaitley ji. I raised this issue. I told him, because I was under the impression that I met the finance minister, I told him, non-plan gap grant for our state has not been given adequately, though revenue is being mobilized and our central share is going to them. I told the finance minister, at least adequate funds have to be given to us. I was thinking that I met the Honorable Prime Minister, as you rightly said, for the purpose of getting additional funds, developing the state. It is every Chief Minister will try. But I was I was fully satisfied when I came to know the same situation is for Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister. Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister could not get appointment for 1 year, and we wanted additional funds because the whatever promises were made to the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister when new state was formed for the Polavaram project, for the Amaravati city construction, and also for the special package, and the making it a special category state. All these things have not been done. Therefore, I got a solace that I'm not being treated, even their allies are also treated like that.
I see. Mr. Narayanasamy, you know, but you seem to like to pass the buck to the center all the time. Let me give you a few of your comments. When demonetization came, you said demonetization is a buffoonery measure introduced by the Modi government that's holding the country to ransom has not achieved its purpose. On the contrary, the country is facing a serious setback in the economy. Puducherry is now suffering a 30% fall in revenue after introduction of GST.
Yes.
You are going...
Even today, I reiterate the same. Because it is not only me. Today, there was a presentation on the GST council meeting. About 24 states, they are not having the revenue buoyancy. Except few states. Few states like northeastern states and Delhi. All other states are revenue deficit. Right from 21% to 54%. It is not only our state. Therefore, you can understand majority of the states, about 22 states, they could not get the revenue which they have been getting when there is a VAT regime. What does it mean?
No, I am unable to understand what you, at one level, you seem to suggest that Puducherry is unique in the manner that you claim it is discriminated against. On the other side, you say all states today, in a way, are suffering as a result of GST. Is that what you are saying, that GST has not benefited state revenues?
In fact, when we talked to in the meeting, when we raised the issue in the GST council, the reply comes from the bureaucrats and also the Honorable Finance Minister is that the slowly the revenue will increase. Because there was a total mess up, right? Including GSTN 1, 2, 3, 4, they didn't make any preparation for the purpose of implementation of GST. They did it in a very haphazard manner. Therefore, whenever if a person wants to file a return, the website is blocked. They are not able to do it. Now, and the e-way bill they brought, e-way bill system is good, I agree. But whatever be the thing, the implementation process is very, 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 very bad, and there is fallacy in that.
Tell me, sir, all of us want to travel to Puducherry. It's a beautiful part of the country. It can even rival Goa, my home state, one of my home states, in terms of its beauty. For you, why have you not been able to do much more for tourism in Puducherry? Why is it that I can't directly fly, for example, from Delhi to Puducherry and explore that entire coastline of the country? Why have you all not been able to achieve what a Goa has been able to achieve? Goa is an equally small state, but look at how far it has gone with tourism. You have lagged behind. Why?
No, because, you know, our government is about 1.5 years old.
You are blaming the previous government.
No, this is a usual... I'm not blaming. And I would like to say that we took steps and the flight services from Hyderabad to Puducherry has been started. It is doing very well. 95% capacity it is flying. It goes via Vijayawada also. Even I would like to tell you, the one ticket from Vijayawada to Puducherry is 28,000 rupees. I was told during the peak season. Therefore, now we are going to start 15th of February, another flight to Bangalore. We are going to extend the runway.
But not enough hotels. You don't have enough hotels. You've not done enough to actually build the tourism potential of Puducherry. Puducherry can rival, as I said, Goa as an alternative tourism site.
I 100% agree with you. The Puducherry city is a population of about 10 lakhs. But the tourist inflow during the period of the festival season, especially during the year end, in December and December 31st and January, 5 lakh people gathered there within 3-4 days. Because there was no sufficient hotel there, I agree with you. We have to create the infrastructure. But we cannot create the infrastructure overnight. There is a process to take and care of. And we are working in that line. Why tourism is flourishing in my state? Because one step which I have taken as a chief minister, bringing law and order under control. I saw to it that the rowdyism, gundaism, the land grabbing, house grabbing, and apart from that, the killing people for ransom, we put gundas in prison. Therefore, the people, because the more number of people, about 40% of the tourists are coming to our state from Karnataka. 20% foreign tourists are coming. The Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, the tourists are about 20-25%. Therefore, it is one of the flourishing states. We have to take step by step. Step by step, we have to do it. We cannot do it. You know, all of a sudden, I cannot build the castle in the air.
Okay. I expected, I can understand what you're trying to say again. But you mentioned gundas and rowdies. Now, the general impression is Puducherry is a lovely, peaceful part of the world. Kiran Bedi is quoted as saying, each politician has around 10 to 15 rowdies that work with them closely. There is a huge nexus in Puducherry between politicians, police and criminals. Is it true?
I tell
Do you also have 10 to 15 rowdies who travel along with you?
You come with me, I will throw you. You come with me. Because I say here in front of all my the valued colleagues that I put my foot down on law and order issue. Law and order. That is the major, the achievement our government made. Because of that, tourism is flourishing. And the infrastructure we have been trying to create, because the comment which Madam Kiran Bedi made, and you can enjoy it, I cannot enjoy.
Sir, but you have a state where your former Assembly Speaker, VMC Shivakumar, was attacked with bombs and then eventually hacked to death in broad daylight. You average around 30 murders a year. These are all figures that have surprised me. In 2017, there were only 2 murders in January, February and March. But since the beginning of April, there have been 12 murders. I thought Puducherry was a very calm area. What is it about Puducherry that you have these mafia wars place?
It is not mafia war. In fact, the people, the rowdies and gundas, when we put them in prison, when they come out, some of them, they kill each other. It is not, because my idea is to see the common people are protected. Their lives should be safe. Their properties should be safeguarded. That is my idea. Because in a state, the 10-12 murders taking place, I would like to reduce it further. We will work in that direction.
You know, I'm only looking at the darker side at the moment of Puducherry.
Now, you will always see that. I know that.
But
You will not see the bright side of the picture.
The bright side is in the India Today State of the State survey. In the small states, on many criteria, Puducherry is well ahead.
Thank you very much for recognizing that.
Okay, so we give the Chief Minister a hand for that, because that is also the truth. But the question though, Mr. Narayan Swamy, is you can do more. You know, medical infrastructure, Puducherry has a huge opportunity to become a place where people can go for medical treatment. These are the areas. Medical tourism is an area of the future. I'm just wondering whether you have not thought far enough. You are still happy in the sense that you've been in power for 1.5 years. You're still celebrating the fact that you are chief minister. You can do much more.
No. I say, as a chief minister, I've been working in 3-4 important areas. Number one, the giving all the support for the people living in the rural areas. They should be provided the medicine, even life-saving medicine should be available in the primary health center. That is our motto. And the people should be given the best treatment even in the rural areas. Education, I would like to tell you, in our state, education, we have got the engineering colleges are about 18, medical colleges are about 8, including in a small state with 15 lakh population. The JIPMER, the research institute is there. And the kind of the education which we are giving, all India level, if you see, according to the survey conducted by the MHRD, we are fifth in the rank in the higher education. Therefore, education is, we are going ahead. As far as the health sector is concerned, health for all, which is the policy of the government of India, we are going to achieve it in a very shortest time.
Many of these colleges, of course, are owned by politicians, but that is true of most of South, in large parts of South India. But just to once again bring out the darker side, BJP President Amit Shah leveled very serious corruption charges against your government. He says, the V. Narayan Swamy-led Congress government in Puducherry is the most corrupt government I have seen in my lifetime. What do you want to tell Amit Shah?
I tell you, the president of the BJP, when he goes to every state, he went to Karnataka state, and there he told the chief minister is a corrupt man. That is his code word in every, wherever Congress ruled states are there. But I give one example to you. There is a politician, I don't want to name anybody, there are some politicians against whom CBI cases are pending. When they join BJP, they become Puritan. They will get minister's post, and they will be recognized, and they will be made party in charge. When Congress party raises the allegation of corruption against the government of the Chhattisgarh, the government of Madhya Pradesh, government of Rajasthan, where his mining scam has been raised by the Congress party as far as Rajasthan is concerned, Madhya Pradesh Vyapam scam, rice scam in Chhattisgarh, no action is taken. The government of India is silent. Prime Minister keeps his mouth shut. But when it comes on the question of Congress ruled state, the CBI will come, the Enforcement Directorate will come, then the income tax will come. If any person whom they wanted to target, immediately all the three organizations will go. I've been seeing this politics because I was a minister for CBI in government of India. I know that we never used the central agencies to take revenge upon any political leaders, anybody in during the period when I was a minister.
Mr. Modi.
But today, day in and day out, in the Bijapur old state, the people are targeted, the industrialists are targeted, the politicians are targeted. They are trying to tarnish the image of the people, and they are trying to destroy the institutions.
Have you received any notice so far? Have you received any notice so far?
When it comes, I will tell you first.
No, because Dr. Kiran Bedi says, for example, medical admissions, there have been irregularities. Two of your IAS officers are allegedly involved. And medical admissions in many cases has become a huge scam, particularly in South India. Many say particularly in your state of Puducherry. Are you willing to make the process of medical admissions transparent?
Because if I explain it, it will take 1 hour. I don't want to go. On this medical, for the first time in our Puducherry's history, for the postgraduate studies in medical education, the government of Puducherry got 50% of the seats. Our local boys and girls, they got about, out of 210, they got about 109. They got 109. The remaining part, according to the government of India guidelines, the health ministry guidelines, it is left to the management to fill up. We are nobody to interfere in that. But the madam said, those seats also should be given to the local people, which is not our mandate, because the guidelines of the government of India was very clear. When those seats have been given to the management to fill it up, it has to be monitored by the government of the health ministry and also MCI. She said there is a huge corruption. Because whenever the issues are there, she only sees from the police angle. She doesn't see from the welfare angle. That is the problem, which the psychological problem which she is facing.
You're now calling her a psychic case. You're effectively calling the lieutenant governor of your state a psychic. You're in trouble, Mr. Narayan Swamy.
I'm telling about psychology. Why you are telling like this?
But why is it? Why is it that the chief ministers of the South almost universally face serious corruption charges? What is it? What is it? We've seen it across the states. Each of them in their tenures end up facing corruption charges. Is it all trumped up? Is it all about CBI being misused? There can be no smoke without fire.
Now, I tell you one thing. As far as the political leaders who are in the realm of affairs, especially chief ministers and ministers are concerned, the allegations are raised by the political rivals and also the people who are against them. But because today, whether any media you see, when there is an allegation against a political leader, the media becomes the prosecutor. Then thereafter, they take a decision. Ultimately, you give judgment. Ultimately, when the case ends in the court, the man is acquitted. This kind of the media trial is going on in this country without knowing what is the actual ground situation. Because all the politicians, it is not only South India, I tell you, 50,000 crores, the mining scam in Rajasthan. Why it is not being investigated? Then the Vyapam scam, how many people died? The medical admission and the job admission. Why investigation has not been made? Therefore, I would like to tell you, because it is very easy to brand any person as a corrupt person. Unless until the allegations are proved, we cannot brand anybody as corrupt. But I tell you, I'm not saying that politicians are not corrupt. Politicians are corrupt. There are about 6 to 7% or 10% politicians are corrupt. I'm not telling, I'm not going to whitewash it. Do you know the bureaucrats? The bureaucrats are also corrupt. But they protect themselves. Then when it comes on the question of businessmen and industrialists, they are not paying tax to the government. They are also corrupting the system. Because, you know, in India, the corruption is everywhere. But it is for the political class. We have to work together to see the corruption is eliminated.
Are you under pressure as one of the few remaining Congress chief ministers in the country? Are you under pressure ki you better either help to provide finance for the party? There are very few Congress chief ministers left. You are one of the last few remaining now.
Sir, I tell you, in politics is an evolution. It is like a cycle. That BJP in 1974, they had only two parliament seats.
84.
Today they are in power. Therefore, don't market the Congress saying that, you know, you are going to only few states are there. We will bounce back. The Congress will come back to power in 2019 in Delhi. In parliament, we will win.
Manish Shankar Iyer clapped the loudest. Will you take him back in your party or not?
He's a born congressman.
He's a?
Born congressman.
Why did you then go ahead and suspend a born congressman?
No, in a political party, there is some disciplinary proceedings. It will be over.
It will be over. You will welcome him back?
No, I tell you one thing. In political parties, they will have to take a call at the appropriate time.
That was a politician statement now.
I am a politician, therefore I am making it.
Let's come back to brand Puducherry in this last segment. How would you like to brand your state? There are lots of people here, including from the world of business, who may want to invest in Puducherry. What is your pitch to them? How do you want to brand Puducherry for the future?
Sir, Puducherry, we would like to bring it as one of the important tourist destination place. That is number one focus. We would like to bring the entertainment park, Disney World, water sports. The facilities are available. The support is available. And from the other angle, for industrial development. Ours is a small state, though lands are not much. We have got a land bank. Our state government is giving a lot of concessions. We announced a new industrial policy. The industrial policy for capital subsidy, interest subsidy, and VAT subsidy. And we are also giving the concession for the industries which are being set up in Puducherry for the purpose of the reduction of the electricity tax. And if the woman entrepreneur would like to invest, we would like to give, we make it as the subsidy is more. That is, we make it as 50% the concession. We are giving a more 50% concession
for a woman
entrepreneurs.
Even if they come from Hyderabad, any part of the country?
Any part of the country. They are women entrepreneurs. Even registration of document by women, we are making it free in our state. Title deeds.
Are you confident that this pitch will work? Do you believe somewhere Puducherry has suffered from the fact because you are Is it an advantage being proximate to Tamil Nadu, which is this economic juggernaut, politically a large influential state? Or is it to your benefit?
As far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, Tamil Nadu is
so
not...
So businessmen tend to go more towards a Tamil Nadu than they would come to a Puducherry.
For industrial development in my state, the Tamil Nadu is not a match to us. Our main the challenge is from Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they are also giving the concession for industrial development, left, right and center. Therefore, to challenge them, to attract more industrialists to our state, we are trying to give more concession to the industrialists who are coming over here. In fact, we would like to give reimbursement, VAT reimbursement, where we have announced whatever we collect tax, we are going to give it to the industrialists so that the industrial development will come to our state.
Let me end on a more personal note. You started your political career or your life in public life as a trade union person.
Yeah.
You were a trade union activist.
Yeah, yeah.
You missed those days. Did you ever imagine in those days as a young trade union activist in Puducherry that one day V. Narayanasamy will be the chief minister of his state?
Because my entry to politics was very accidental. In fact, I was doing the trade union activities. I was a lawyer by profession. I was practicing. Then I came into contact, Mr. Shanmugam, who was a member of parliament 4 times there. Then thereafter, when one parliament seat fell vacant, Rajya Sabha seat, in 1985, in fact, our leader, Rajiv Gandhiji, called all the aspirants. About 15 people were called for personal interview. That was the first case where the personal interview was held by the Rajiv Gandhi ji in 1985.
Rajiv Gandhi did personal interviews to choose who will be the Rajya Sabha candidate from Puducherry?
Puducherry, yes, he did it. And there, I went as the commoner, I went there. But I was not very serious about getting it because stalwarts were there, former ministers, of the former the senior leaders were there. When I went there, Mr. Farooq was the chief minister at that time. Then I got a call from Mupanarji, he was general secretary in charge, that you have been selected by Rajiv Gandhiji, you should come and take the A form, B form. I was surprised. Then when I went there, Rajivji blessed me and gave me the form. And that was my entry into politics. I think unique case I find, I was the only person who has been interviewed for the purpose of getting Rajya Sabha seat in Congress history. Thereafter, my political journey continued because therefore I said it was accidental. I didn't go as a person who will be getting the seat, but I went as one of the aspirants. But it clicked for me because Rajiv Gandhiji selected me because when I told him that I've been doing the trade union activities, then he asked me several questions, which I cannot divulge now to you. And through personal entry, I was selected. Therefore, that is an honor for me.
It is an honor for you. And I was told that the secret of your success is that you are ever smiling. That the one thing about V. Narayanasamy, even when you were in government and under pressure in the department of which you were handling of CBI and personnel, and you had to solve all these politically contentious cases for various leaders, the one thing when they came to you...
No, as a parliamentary affairs minister...
You are a very good parliamentary affairs minister because you always used to smile with everyone.
Yeah, because unless until how to manage Keshav Rao and Manishankar Iyer. Unless until I am very friendly with them, it is not possible for me. Therefore, I used to carry everybody. As a minister of parliamentary affairs, I used to go and sit with the BJP leaders, talk to them, try to persuade them. And ultimately, we were able to run the parliament because fortunately for me, the leader of the Lok Sabha was the honorable former president of India, was the leader of the Lok Sabha, Rai Sabha, honorable Dr. Manmohan Singh was there. And therefore, we had a cordial relationship.
You should use the same smile now to woo Narendra Modi. When you go to Delhi and you need money for Puducherry, you should show him the same smile, sit with him.
Have you seen the photograph when I met him about 15 days back? With the Honorable Prime Minister, both were smiling. He was smiling, I was smiling. And ultimately result was zero.
So you're saying that you went and smiled with Narendra Modi. Y'all both smiled at each other, but the result was zero. So he didn't give you the funds you wanted. No,
even if I fight with him, the same will be the result.
Are you saying that Congress chief ministers are being discriminated against?
It is obvious. Why do you want me from my mouth? It is obvious that all the Congress chief ministers are being targeted.
No, targeted is one thing. Discriminated. You're saying you went to ask for funds from Narendra Modi. You had a lovely photo op of both of you smiling at each other, but the result was zero. And you're saying that is, but you've also admitted that Chandrababu Naidu didn't get an appointment for several months. So you're not feeling now so bad.
That's what Andhra leaders were telling me.
So you're not feeling as bad as you were that day.
No, I'm not feeling bad. When Chandrababu Naidu was treated like that, I'm far better than him.
Mr. Narayan Swamy, you know, over these 40 years that you've now been in politics, your favorite memory of politics, we are trying to personalize you. We are trying to understand the man behind the politician. Your favorite memory in all these years of having been in public life. Do you have a favorite memory that you would like to
now,
share?
One quote I got from Sitaram Kesari ji when he was the treasurer of the party. I asked him, what is the secret of your success? As a treasurer of the party for a long time. He told me, that always keeps in my memory, Narayan Swamy, the politics is like fire. If you go nearby, you will be finished. If you little away, you are finished. But you should be in the middle to enjoy the warmth. That I have been following.
How do you achieve that?
That is what I am telling, the secret.
Think of poor Manishankar Iyer there. He has gone too close.
No, Manishankar is one extreme.
He is one extreme. So that is to Mr. Pallam, Raju, to Keshav, all of them who are listening to you, you have given a good piece of advice. Don't go too close to the fire, it will burn you. Don't stay too far away, you will be isolated. Stay in the middle.
And enjoy the warmth.
And enjoy the warmth. Well, that's a lovely way on which to end. Because the one thing with you, Mr. Narayan Swamy, is that you've always had this sense of humor through good times and bad. You've always stayed in the middle, which is why you've managed to survive and endure various presidents of the Congress Party, prime ministers and government changes. And now you're the chief minister of the lovely state of Puducherry. I hope a lot of people who are here in the audience visit your state. I'm sure you're off giving an open invitation to everyone here.
My request to all the businessmen or industrialists is that ours is a very, very, though smaller state, in one day, the businessmen or industrialists who come to my state, they can meet the chief minister without appointment. They can meet the ministers. They can meet the bureaucrats. And we will ensure that the procedure is simplified for the purpose of investment in our state.
So single window clearance,
already
no appointment.
It is there in our new industrial policy.
So someone can come and walk straight into your secretariat, appointment.
Nobody seek appointment with me. Right, our own people and the people who come from outside, I can meet them anytime. In the morning, I meet people in my residence after 10 o'clock. Up to 2, anybody can walk into my office to meet me. I don't have any ego. I don't think that I'm a chief minister of a state and keep myself under the shelves, because I'm also a commoner.
Do you have a siren and all that? Are you like all these chief ministers of the big state with paraphernalia of security?
I tell you one thing. The administrator, lieutenant governor, when she became the lieutenant governor of my state, she announced that siren is to be removed. Then I took a decision that I will not use official car, I will use my personal car. I am using my personal car even today. I am not using the official car. Therefore, I went one step further, because I know the drama of the Kiran Bedi ji.
She's still haunting you.
I can address the issues. Because when I am right, when my path is right, I need not bother about anybody.
Mr. Narayan Swamy, you've given us a sense into a taste as to what a successful politician can be, particularly of a small state. You've, in a sense, given this entire audience.
You extracted the secret from me.
And you've given this entire audience an open invite to the lovely state where you can get spiritual tourism through the Aurobindo Ashram.
Because we have three kinds of tourism in our state.
Yes.
Lesser tourism, spiritual tourism, and the other one is heritage tourism. We preserve the French culture, French architecture in our state. And apart from that, if you go to Puducherry, you can enjoy the hospitality of the even 40,000 the French citizens are living in my state. They are comfortable in our state. Therefore, my red carpet welcome to all the industries and businessmen. Please come and invest in our state.
You are a true melting pot. The wonderful state of Puducherry and Mr. V. Narayan Swamy. Please give him a very big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Lovely. Went on very well.
Thank you, Rajdeep. I'll request you to kindly stay on stage. I'll request the Chief Minister also to kindly stay on stage. And thank you so much, Chief Minister of Puducherry, V. Narayan Swamy, for extending that invite to visit Puducherry. But before we wrap up things here, I would like to kindly call on stage CEO for the India Today Group, Vivek Khanna, because he has some exciting news for each one of us. Vivek, please share with us the great news.
Thank you so much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'll just have three pieces of news to share with you. I won't take time, sir. Please kindly sit down. The Indian readership survey came out this afternoon, and I'm really, really delighted to announce that across all genres, all languages, the largest read magazine in the country is India Today English. It has a total readership of close to 80 lakh. The second piece of good news is that the magazine which has come number two in the survey is India Today Hindi. So India Today put together has a combined readership between English and Hindi, a total readership of 80 lakhs in English and 71 lakhs in Hindi, which is really fantastic. And we would like to thank every single reader and all those who've been contributing to the publication for this. The third piece of good news is that the largest read business magazine in the country, yet again, is Business Today. We really wanted to share this with all of you who've made this day really exciting and fascinating. And I thought I'll take this platform and 2 minutes of your time to do so. Thank you very much.
Vivek, thank you so much, and this was wonderful news. Let's hear a huge round of applause for all of our employees of the India Today Group. Fantastic, great, congratulations once again. And how can I not call the Editor-in-Chief and Chairman of the India Today Group, Mr. Arun Puri, for his reactions to this absolutely amazing bit of news.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can only back up what Mr. Vivek Khanna has said. I couldn't be more delighted with this result. I have been working in India Today for 42 years. And it's seen its ups and it's seen its downs. And it's just wonderful news to know that we're right on top and that magazine readership has increased. People keep saying people don't read magazines anymore. I don't believe it, and I think this readership survey says it. Because with this onslaught of digital onslaught, or digital tsunami, I would say, and the TV news, which you see 24 hours, there are actually 400 news channels in India, you won't believe it, 24-hour news channels. So there's a cacophony of news. And I think magazines like India Today provide you perspective, provide you analysis in a long form of serious journalism, And I believe there will always be a readership who wants that kind of journalism. And I would like to thank all those people who have supported us in all these years. And I'm sure that magazine readership and journalism of this kind will continue to thrive in India. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Mr. Narayanasamy, would you like to respond to that absolutely fabulous bit of news about India Today?
Do you read India?
Narayanasamy, do you read India Today or not?
See, India Today is my favorite magazine. Any politician who don't read India Today, you will not be successful. Because I go to the bookstall in the airport, I purchase India Today, and I read it in the flight because I find time there only. And therefore, I think you can be rest assured that India Today is one of the popular magazine, which, because, you know, they are giving unbiased news. That is the beauty of India Today. Therefore, I trust India Today.
So if we don't write nice things about you in the magazine, you will still read it?
I will welcome it.
Very.
Because why I'm telling, because, you know, there is a reason for it. When a politician or a chief minister or a minister, when people garland you take it, you are proud of it. When you are doing something which is not acceptable to the people, when they criticize you, you should have the heart to accept it. That is more important part of a political person. Because don't think that, you know, because that man is criticizing you, don't be angry with them. And we will correct ourselves by the information that has been given to us. Therefore, India Today, if they criticize me more, I will be more popular.
Great.
You've given us lots of lessons in how to be a successful politician. Stay away from the fire.
Now, in future, you will also become politician. Don't worry.
No, I think, and that's what's the strength of the India Today magazine.
I like to be in the fire, that's why.
May I please call on stage T.S. Kalyan Raman. He's the CMD for Kalyan Jewelers. For a small token of our thanks, appreciation to the Chief Minister of Puducherry. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the grand finale. It's the last session for the day. Let's all give a rousing reception to the Chief Minister of Puducherry. Thank you so much. Thank you once again.